Like Father, Like Son, a Family Story. Written and read by Michael Parkinson and Mike Parkinson, with extracts read by Simon Slater. Preface.
I'll start with a memory of my father that was featured in a collection of my articles called Parkinson's Law, published in 1981. What I wrote then still sums up what I feel about him today. I was never told fairy tales as a child. Instead, I heard about Larwood's action and Jack Hobbs' perfection. Before I ever saw him play, I knew Len Hutton intimately. And the first time I witnessed Stanley Matthews in the flesh, I knew which way he was going, even if the fullback didn't. The stories of these gods and many, many more besides I heard at my father's knee. He was a remarkable man with a marvellous facility to adorn an anecdote. It was he who invented the gate complete with a tendant, which was built in honour of a Barnsley winger who could run like the wind but didn't know how to stop. At the end of one of his gallops, the gate will be open and the winger will career out of the ground and finally come to a stop halfway across the car park. Oh, so Dad said. It was he who told me of the full-back whose fearsome sliding tackles carried him into the wall surrounding the pitch, causing the spectators to start wearing goggles at home games for fear of being blinded by flying chips of concrete. He claimed that a maverick and eccentric player called Frank Barson once ran the entire length of the field, bouncing the ball on his head, beat the opposing goalkeeper, and then headed his final effort over the crossbar because he'd had a row with his manager before the game. And moreover, the old man swore he managed to see Len Hutton's 364 at the Oval by convincing the gate attendant that he was dying of some incurable disease, and his last wish was to see Len before he took leave of this earth. I never swallowed that one until once at a football match when the gates were closed, I witnessed him convince the gateman that he was a journalist and I was his runner. I was about 7 at the time, and it was the very first occasion I ever watched a football match from a press box. Apart from being a fairy storyteller, he was one of the best all-round sportsmen I've ever come across. He loved any game, and as soon as he took it up, he played it well. As a cricketer, he was a quick bowler with an action copied from his great hero, Harold Larwood. He had a marvellous agility and a sure pair of hands near the bat, and as a batsman, he was a genuine number 11 who often didn't know whether he'd play left or right-handed until he got to the crease. Not that it made much difference. Of all games, he loved cricket the most. He judged everything and everyone by the game. The only time I ever saw him lost for words was when someone confessed they neither knew nor cared about cricket. Then he would shake his head, sadly baffled that a great part of his world, for cricket was surely that, could mean so little to any other sane human being. Once a friend and I took him to Headingley and sat him behind the bowler's arm, and he never moved all day. We bought him pork pies and sandwiches and good Yorkshire beer, and he sat under his native sun watching Lily bowl fast, and he was the happiest man on our planet. You always knew where my old man would be on any cricket ground, right behind the bowler's arm. Moreover, if you ever lost him, or he lost himself, as he often did, being born without a sense of direction, you simply asked the whereabouts of the nearest cricket ground, and there you'd discover the old man sitting contentedly awaiting the arrival of his search party. In his younger days, his favourite holiday was a week at Scarborough, which he reckoned had the best beach wicket in Britain, or Butlins, not because he particularly cared for the idea of a holiday camp, but because of these sporting competitions. He used to enter the lot and normally came home with a couple of trophies for snooker or running or the mixed wheelbarrow race. He entered everything and anything and owed much of his success to his ability to talk an opponent to death. I once heard an irate tennis opponent say to him, "Doesn't that ever shut the gob?" "Only when other people are talking," said my old man with a disarming smile. When he finished playing, he took up coaching, first the local youngsters and latterly his 3 grandchildren. They, like me, are left-handed batsmen, not because God made them so, but because the old man's theory was not many players like bowling at left-handers. His other theory, based on a lifetime's experience, was that fast bowlers are crazy, so he determined to make at least one of my sons a slow bowler. The consequence of this is I once had the only 8-year-old googly bowler in the Northern Hemisphere. At 10, he added the top spinner to his repertoire, and when he was 12, the old man's face was a picture as his protege beat me with a googly and then had me plumb in front of the dustbin with one that hurried off the pitch and came straight through. The old man's name was John William, and he hated John Willie. If anyone addressed him thus when he was playing in his prime, the red alert went up and the casualty ward at Barnsley Beckett Hospital could look forward to receiving visitors. He's been dead for many years now, but I still think about him because he was a special man, and I was lucky to know him. He was a Yorkshireman, a miner, a humorist and a fast bowler. Not a bad combination. I only hope they play cricket in heaven. If they don't, he'll ask for a transfer. This book is a tender tribute to a wonderful man, an attempt to understand the grip of grief and the emotional minefield that is the relationship between a father and a son, and to see how much was passed on to me by him and what still lives within me. It is, in its heart, a love letter from me and every part of my family, lucky enough to know my father, John William Parkinson. It is, however, a book that's had a long gestation period, mainly because of my resistance to it. It is one that my friend and long-time publisher, Roddy Bloomfield, has had in mind ever since he began compiling the pieces that I wrote for the Sunday Times and other publications into books on cricket, football and sport in general, and discovered that alongside Skinner Normanton, Muscle Edie and the other sporting luminaries of my youth, the figure that appeared most prominently in my pen portraits of sport in a northern mining village and the role it played in my childhood was my father. Roddy's appetite for a book that concentrates upon this enormous influence on my life was increased by the publication of my autobiography, Parky, in 2008. He has been politely pushing the issue ever since, while I've been politely diverting his attention with offerings on Muhammad Ali and George Best, as well as some fulsome pitching of other ideas for books, such as the history of the Grimthorpe Colliery Band, a celebration of the hitherto little-known sport of South Yorkshire competitive clog dancing, and a cookery book entitled Parky's 100 Recipes with Forced Rhubarb. Undeterred, Roddy has kept up the pressure, but being a man of impeccable manners, his insistence makes me feel like a recalcitrant sinner being pursued by a softly spoken, bookish Monsignor. However, there is a serious reason why I've only got around to writing this now, and that's because I felt that in the piece that I mentioned above, I told my father's story, or at least in the way I wanted to remember it, and in doing so, made clear my love for him and the influence he had on me. But then I agreed to appear on Piers Morgan's talk show, and the book was finally born.
Chapter 1. Life Stories. Before Piers Morgan's desire to hold our largely ineffectual and incompetent political master's feet to the fire, for the handling of the pandemic had elevated him to a renewed position of eminence and respect among fellow journalists, I was a somewhat lone voice in my appreciation of his talent. He is certainly a divisive, controversial figure, with an ego that at times can make him capable of moments of crass showboating. But his command of the live television environment, his intelligence and breadth of interests, and his journalistic instincts make him a compelling performer. I was not prepared, however, for him to be the most unlikely inspiration for this book. I had for a number of years declined his many invitations to appear on his show, Life Stories. I'd always had a slight problem with the format, which mixes a traditional Life and Times talk show with elements of This Is Your Life. And I'm also uncomfortable with what seems to be the entire purpose of the show, which is to guarantee the spectacle of lachrymose celebrities. However, having now personally endured the 3-hour-plus recording time, part of me suspects that for some guests the tears are caused not by a painful memory, but by the dawning realization that they may not see their homes again before the world's end. Then a couple of years ago, Piers kindly gave up his time to do an interview with me in aid of the Lord's Taverners, of which I was then president, and we agreed as a quid pro quo that I would appear on Life Stories. I found Piers to be a combative, engaging interviewee, and we covered a range of subjects from sport to the price of fame, and his then close relationship with President Trump, whilst also revealing that he must have a strong death wish, given his decision to become human target practice for the Australian fast bowler Brett Lee in the nets of Melbourne Cricket Ground, not to mention his choice to use his position as host of his own CNN show in America to stand up to the NRA gun lobbyists, who have members that prefer to settle arguments with an assault rifle rather than an on-air debate. Piers was a great addition to the Taverners event, which raised thousands to enable underprivileged and disabled kids access to cricket, that most glorious of games. And so it came to pass that I found myself sitting in an Elstree recording studio opposite the Grand Inquisitor Piers Morgan. I've been a journalist all my working life, and I feel I know every trick of the trade, and therefore, as an interviewee, I'm confident I know how to avoid the inconvenient question. So despite being advised by those close to me that the sole purpose of the show would be to delve into potentially painful areas of my life in an attempt to elicit the holy grail of a celebrity sob, I was fairly certain that I could avoid that particular fate. Knowing also that he likes a challenge, I had even told Piers before the interview that there was no way he was going to make me cry. The fact is, I've had a charmed life, a largely untroubled upbringing, a strong and enduring marriage, sons who still talk to me, and a career that for the most part has been fulfilling and lucrative. The only really difficult times I have had were dealing with the death of my father and the overwhelming grief that threatened to derail me, plus my brief sojourn into the sad backwater of a drink problem. But I have openly talked and written about both, explaining that they were not wholly but definitely interlinked. And moreover, they happened over 30 years ago, so I had no reason to suspect that I would become another entry in Piers Morgan's Hall of Fame, sponsored by Kleenex. Other brands are available. How wrong I was. When he asked me about losing my father, I didn't just cry, I sobbed. I was taken completely by surprise. In the aftermath of the show, I tried to rationalise why it had happened. Why did this particular interview open up a door to my feelings about my father that had been kept to anyone outside the family and close friends, maybe not fully shut, but at least only partly ajar? Looking back now, I think the reason may lie in the fact that I was not fully prepared for how different Life Stories would be from any other televised interview I had done before. It was an interesting but unsettling experience because the style was so foreign to me. My aim as an interviewer was always to establish a relationship and rapport with, a couple of exceptions aside, a person who is basically a stranger in even stranger surroundings. I achieved that, I believe, by being reactive in my style of interviewing, in the sense that I always prepared as well and as diligently as I could, shaping the interview into an editorially linked and justified series of questions. I went into each encounter confident of my subject, which gave me license to listen carefully to the answers and judge the mood and demeanour of the guest in order to be ready to, as it were, go off script. The result was that if, as often happened, my initial questions elicited an answer to a question I was planning to ask later in the interview, or if a general response in either body language or tone in the interviewee indicated that access to their story down that particular avenue was going to be difficult, I could seek an alternative, even if perhaps it wasn't exactly the interview I had in mind. It's a style that suited my personality, and I believe some of my very best interviews have been when I have only asked perhaps one or two of my prepared questions, and it has then developed into a natural, free-flowing conversation. The other thing I always insisted on was that the programme should be done as if live. If it overran by too much, anything over 20 minutes, To me, it was a bad sign in that it indicated I had felt the need to go fishing beyond the scope of the prepared interview because I was unsure of the quality of what we had already recorded. In a sense, I produced the interview as I conducted it, wary of leaving too much to be done in the edit, which always, to my mind, resulted in a stilted, unnatural end product. There are exceptions, of course. In their prime, Billy Connolly, Peter Ustinov, David Attenborough, and the like could and should, for the benefit of the common weal, have been interviewed nightly for at least an hour until they ran out of things to say, or more likely the interviewer reached retirement age. But most interviewers should heed the maxim of the late Conservative politician Lord Mancroft, whose advice, although he was specifically talking about making a speech, can easily be applied to the arena of the interview. A speech is like a love affair. Any fool can start one, but to end it requires considerable skill. Piers is no fool, but he is a very different beast to me. He approaches an interview for Life Stories as if it is a profile piece for a magazine, in that there is seemingly no time limit to the interview, and the shape will be decided after he has reviewed all the footage. The effect on the interviewee is that you leave with little sense of how it went, except that you may have said too much, or been too unguarded, and slightly concerned about how the content will be shaped once it disappears into the edit suite. It's as if you've been gently turned over by a Savile Row-suited mugger. He's a very bright man, a good interviewer, but it quickly becomes clear he is not much interested in a free-flowing, mutually-led conversation. He has decided what he wants you to talk about and when he wants you to talk about it. I think I am a very easy interviewee, in that I know how difficult it can be if the participant is unwilling, and therefore I try to frame my answers in a way that leads the interviewer to the most interesting parts of my life as quickly as possible, although it is also true that, like most of us who are in the public eye, I do tend to fall back on the tried and tested anecdotes, some of which, admittedly, through overexposure, have begun to lose some of their lustre. I tried this approach early on with Piers, but he was having none of it. In Life Stories, you are very much a subject in the court of King Piers, and in his iron grip, no amount of obfuscation or verbal wriggling on your part will throw him off the scent. The interview is divided into structured sections, in which certain aspects of your life are picked over in painstaking detail until he is satisfied, and no deviation from or abbreviation of this section is allowed. He also gives a masterclass in emotional manipulation, as he constantly prevents you from falling back into your protective routine of remembrance by asking you to think afresh about the events in your life and to express your feelings about them, reassuring you that it is only human to have feelings. He then drip-feeds into the interview filmed inserts of contributions from dear friends and beloved family members, often as a punctuation mark to signify the beginning of a new section, but also as a way to augment the feeling that you are being slowly led to a crescendo lurking somewhere in the third hour of the programme. And bang on cue, as we entered the third hour of the interview, Piers asked me about the two aspects of my life that, as I have said, have caused the most difficulty. The first rapier thrust, concerning my drinking, was parried easily enough. I had been very open about my drink problem, which began to take hold at around the time the first run of Parkinson was coming to a close. I had been asked many times in interviews about why and how, as the great Sir Les Paterson put it, I gave the grog a nudge. So I had no problem talking again about what I thought were the causes, how bad it got, and the role that my wife Mary played in getting me by the short and curlies and pulling me back onto the right track. As with many addictions, the causes are complicated and myriad, a mixture of genetic and environmental, but it was definitely the case that one contributing factor was the death of my father. Cue the next en garde. Again, I was unconcerned and perfectly happy to talk about this. I believe that while I had perhaps not fully come to terms with it, let's face it, who does? I'd packed it safely away in the jumbled attic of my memories to ensure I was sufficiently insulated against it. To be honest, I don't know what happened. I was certainly totally unprepared for the violence of my reaction. Perhaps it was what had gone before. Remembering events in a fresh way. The constant refrain of not being ashamed of feelings. The heartfelt and moving filmed inserts, particularly the one featuring my eldest boy, Andrew, being visibly moved when he was talking about his grandfather. Or perhaps it was the growing feeling that I might need to spend a night in the local travel lodge. Not that there is anything wrong with that, except I don't like the pillows, if the interview wasn't brought to an end soon. All that undoubtedly prepared the ground. But the tipping point was the simple yet skillful question Piers asked. He didn't deal in generalities, but asked me specifically to recall feelings that come to mind when I think about the day my father died. And, like Banquo at the feast, into my head sprang a terrible image that had lurked in the shadows for so long. We had brought my father home to die, and when he passed away, I couldn't cope with the organisation of the removal of the body to the funeral home. It meant that I was unprepared for the sight of my beloved dad being removed by two strangers in what amounted to a large zip-up plastic bag. It was this image that for some reason came into my mind when Piers asked the question. As is true of most men of my generation, crying does not come easily. And in my book, crying in public on a national television show is a definite no-no. But the tears came. And when they did, it was difficult to stop them. I was overwhelmed by a whole raft of unexpected emotions. Thinking back, I now know what is meant by that tired old cliche of your life flashing before your eyes. For me, it was not a highlights reel of my life, but a jumble of emotions that came cascading from God knows what hiding place. There was grief, certainly, and a sense of loss, but also regret and shame, mixed with a sense of wonder that such a man had been my dad. To rationalise, process and express all these feelings at that moment was impossible. I was paralysed, pinned like a rare butterfly. To his credit, Piers, with suitable care and no little skill, ensured the moment didn't become too uncomfortable for me, the studio audience, or the viewer, by empathising and by asking me to try to explain why I still felt my father's loss so strongly. I simply answered that it was because he was a much better man than I was. Pick the bones out of that, Sigmund Freud. My son Mike was at the recording, and we met afterwards to talk about what had occurred. He was as shocked as I was that a man who had died more than 40 years ago could still affect me in that way. As we mull this over, and also consider the way Andrew had spoken so movingly about his grandfather, an idea began to form. We looked at each other, and both said perhaps Roddy is right. There is a book there, but maybe not in the way he envisaged it. The book that has emerged is much more than simply a collection of reminiscences, many of which are contained in some of the better articles I wrote about my father, though we will still revisit these as they remain enlightening, stand the test of time, and still capture the sense of my relationship with him and the nature of the man. They recall his sporting obsessions, his sense of humour, and his lifelong determination to produce from either his son or three grandsons a cricketer worthy of playing for his beloved Yorkshire. In that sense, we are all a huge disappointment to him. But in addition, and for the first time, the book also attempts to explore where my father came from and what shaped him in life before I was even a twinkling in his eye. On top of that, it's the story of my dad, John William Parkinson, told from my son Mike's perspective. And it reveals how, as a grandfather and father-in-law, he touched and transformed every member of the family, which is why it is written in relay form, with Mike and me taking turns to move the story forward. As a consequence, the book contains two distinctive but complementary viewpoints which get to the heart of this fascinating family story, but also prove that, in writing ability at least, the apple has...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.